I believe more information that he would have given to you. So right this time, let's welcome Pastor Terrence.
All right. Good morning, church. Thank you, Brother Raymond. The last time I came, you called me pastor. Today, you call me reverend. The next time, I'll be the pope. So good to be here. My name is Terrence. My wife, Deborah. We flew in this morning. Our flight was 5:25 a.m. We arrived in KLIA at about 8 a.m. Thank God there was no delay. And and now we are direct here. So good to be here. You guys are a happening church, right? Everyone say happening. You know, when Brian Raymond said there was the 70s choir, I quickly told my wife, Elvis is coming out. Watch. And I said, they're going to come out with baggy pants. But I was so disappointed, you know. Okay. We are here, back here to celebrate Christmas with our family. But I really thank God for Kajang, AOG, for inviting us to be here. And it's a tall order, I feel, and a privilege and an honor to share the Word of God this morning for a very familiar occasion, right? How many of you know that the proverb, familiarity breeds contempt? We all know the story of Christmas, left, right, and center. We know the story of Easter, left, right, center. Just like some of you who have been married 20, 30 years, you know your husband and or your wife, and you say, there's nothing new in the sun anymore, right, about one another. But that's the danger of it, right? That's the danger, and I'm speaking for myself, that's the danger of being a Christian for slightly too long. We become too familiar with the Word of God. We become too familiar with even coming to church on a normal Sunday, that sometimes we return back with nothing. And today I pray that the Lord will do a surgery in your heart and my heart. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You're not convinced. I pray today that the Lord will do a surgery in your heart and my heart. Yeah. And when I say surgery, it will hurt, it will be painful, but it is necessary. All right, for growth and for our, from glory to glory, from strength to strength. Can I have the slides, the pictures up? Yeah, if you don't mind. So we have two kids. Our children, both our children came back last week. So my mom went over to KK Sabah and I brought them back last week. So they have been here. We really can't bring them here because the grandparents locked the house. Don't allow them out because they hardly get to spend time with them. So in replace, Deb is here. We've been married for 11 years. I know I look young, okay? We've been married for 11 years. I am still young. We met each other in youth group in church. And then eventually we fell in love. We dated and then we got married. And then we have two kids. Seth is 6. Enya is 3. Last October, am I supposed to? Okay. Last October, so 2 months back, it was the final year concert for their Tadika. So this is special for us because Seth is his final year and Enya is her first year. And it's the first time and only time that they will be presenting together. So the school did a very interesting thing. They did the Lion King, the musical, right? And they involve all the class. It's not like the normal how you go for concert. Each class do a presentation, but it's the entire story and they weave in different class in the whole scene. Seth was privileged because he's the senior class, so they let him play Mufasa and the adult Simba. When they came back in July, when they came back home and they broke the news to us, the two children, mommy, mommy, daddy, daddy, guess what we're doing? We're doing the Lion King. I say, great, right? A few days later, Seth came back, mom, the teacher called me to the office. I said, oh my goodness. The principal is Allison. Teacher Allison called me to the office, mom. I said, why? What did you do? No, she told me I'll be Mufasa. I said, whoa, we celebrated. The whole family was so happy. Oh, yes, you're Mufasa. Okay, let's memorize the song, blah, blah, blah. Few days later, they came back with songs, then actions, and then dance, and then scripts. And it went along. We were so both of us, we were so enthralled. Video them, take photo, you know what modern day parents do, video everything, right? But slowly, they went on an OD, not overdrive, but overdose, okay? Everything was about Lion King, okay? In the morning when we go to school, instead, I want to hear worship song. They say, Daddy, play Lion King. Play this song. Come back home. They want me to play on Spotify, Hakuna Matata, and so on and so forth. That at the end of the year, Spotify actually credited me. My best song, top song, is Lion King. Now, I bet you today, if I bring Seth and Enya up and I say, or I ask them, can you sing the song? Even if it's 2 months ago, they can do it like that, no problem. However, if I were to say, Seth, come up here, stand here, and do that particular scene, he would freeze. Or if I call my daughter, Enya, come up here, I'll play this song. Okay, do that dance. Remember that dance, this and so on and so forth. Can you do it? She would freeze. Or if I go to your house after this and have meal with you all and we talk and we interrupt Seth or Enya if they're with us and I say, hey, come, show auntie, show uncle, come and do this. They probably won't. Why? Because the stage that now I set for them is unfamiliar. You follow me? It's because the crowd all of a sudden become so unfamiliar with them. There's no rehearsal, there's no planning, there's no briefing, there's no setup, there's nothing. All of a sudden, I say, Seth, come here, come, let's do the Lion King. Although he memorized the script left, right, and center, OD, overdose, right? It's because the stage that was set, I'm setting for him, is a very unfamiliar place. How many of you all know that the Christmas story is a story set in a very unfamiliar setting? Very unfamiliar. The people, the Jewish people were waiting for a king. Some thought that were hoping for a king from the tribe of Levi. They were the doers, they were the worshippers, they were the priests. But no, it came from the tribe of Judah. The virgin birth, what's that, you know, at that time, right? Even today, doesn't make sense. The king coming in the form of baby, it's unfamiliar. Or the parents that is taking care of the king or giving birth to the Messiah had to hide away from the earthly king to ensure the safety of the Messiah. It's a very unfamiliar setting. But today I pray that 2,000 years ago when it became unfamiliar, today I pray that it will still be unfamiliar to us. You know why? It's so that we don't get so used to how God works. And that's the danger. And that's why sometimes in our Christian faith, in our walk, we come to a plateau. We come to a place where, que sera, sera. Whatever will be, will be. Let's pray. Father, I pray this morning that the word of God will be like a double-edged sword and will change and will transform and will inspire us. Lord, I pray, even as we come to you and hear the word of God, that you will do a new thing in our lives. Some of us maybe have been Christians for 10 over years, 20 over years, but God, I pray that you work in us as though we are a new believer. Father, we commit ourselves to you. We commit the word of God to you in Jesus' name. And everybody say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. If you can turn your Bibles with me, turn to Matthew chapter 1. Verse 18 until the end. I'm reading from the NLT version, the New Living Translation. And we are very familiar with this passage, but let us go through once. This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. So the stage is set. This is how. We're talking about the birth of Jesus Christ. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her publicly. So he decided to break. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded and took Mary as his wife. But he did not have sexual relations with her until her son was born. And Joseph named him Jesus. The whole Christmas story is layered with interruptions. Somebody say interruption. Look at your neighbor, look in the eyes and say interruptions. If I can title today's message, it would be, probably you can, I don't think this is working, or is this working? Yeah, you can move the slide for me. If I can title today's message, the title would be Christmas, the Story of Interruptions. Right? If you know the whole story of Christmas is filled with interruption. Joseph and Mary, what had just happened? They just got engaged. Now, if Joseph has my mind, there'll be 101 things to do. I just got engaged, ma, right? Who's going to be on my guest list? What is the color theme for my wedding? So they have 1 year, all right? In the Jewish custom, they have 1 year to wait. Who's going to be on our wedding list? Where is the location? We need plan A. We need plan B. What if dinner under the stars? It rains. What happened? What's our plan B, right? Who is the pastor? All of this, they will need to plan. Now, but all of a sudden, he got interrupted by a... Can you move to the next? He got interrupted by a... Can you move to my next slide, please? Yeah. Can you see this? It's a WhatsApp message by Mary to Joseph. And Mary's first message says, hey. Now, husbands, when your wife sends you a message called hey, it's serious. I don't know about you, husband and wife, but me and my wife, we don't call each other hey, or hi, or hello. No, we call each other darling, dear, and so on and so forth. But if your wife one day message you and say, hey, something's up, right? Now, men, you need to process this three-letter word. Hey, you need to pray and meditate how you respond, okay? Serious, because what you're going to reply is going to cause either will make or break. You're going to sleep on the bed or sleep on the floor, okay, tonight. And then, next. So what you're going to respond is this. It doesn't seem to be working. Hey, hey again. I still can't remember what is up there, so that's why I can't go off the fly. That's dangerous, huh? Interruption. In Jesus' name. And then you say, hey, baby, how was your morning? You try to ignore the hey, okay? You try to twist it around. What man work for bad, evil, you make it for good, ma, the Bible says. So you say, hey, baby, hey, honey, what? How was your morning? Then what the wife say? Right, I'm supposed to press, is it? We need to talk. When your wife or your girlfriend say we need to talk, it's not a chat, okay? She doesn't mean take her out for a date and talk. It she means some serious business is happening. Now, you got a few options here, lah, man, okay? Firstly, you don't click the message. Means don't show blue tick, all right? You show blue tick, all right? The women will process it as though he has read, but he's not interested to reply, right? Next option, okay, is you know how your phone, you can swipe down, but you can read the blurb, huh? So you do that, okay? So that's why I'm teaching you lah, the art of marriage. How to keep your marriage going, 101. So you scroll down and you read, all right? We need to talk. Then you pray, okay? And then you give a long reply. You say, okay, sure. You want to talk? Okay, sure, no problem. Do you want me to come over? You want me to come now? So marriage technique, huh? Always be there, okay? Always be there for them. And then all of a sudden, she will send you this image. Go back. Send you an image of a pregnancy test. Two lines. Jang, jang, jang. Actually, you see, if you can see from at the back, the timestamp is there's a 10-minute. We need to talk 11:31 and then 11:41. So you gave yourself a 10-minute buffer to think, to process what she's trying to talk. What did I do wrong? What did I say yesterday? What did I say this morning? Did I do anything right? Do I do anything wrong? You see, women, we men, we prefer you to tell us direct, ma, right? Hey, men, come on, are you on my side or not? And then Mary sent him this message while Joseph was processing the entire wedding plan. She sent him this image of them being pregnant. Oh my goodness, he's like, what's the first thing in his mind? So in the Jewish culture, when you're betrothed or you're engaged, you are as husband and wife. The only difference is you don't consummate the marriage physically, right? And you need to wait 1 year. And Joseph, the Bible says he's a righteous man. If they had sexual relations or she had sexual relations outside, it's akin to divorce, all right? Akin to adultery, which will equal to divorce. So that's serious. Now, Joseph, life just got interrupted by this with all his plans in mind. Well, how could he react? Let's look at what the Bible says, right? The Word of God says this, as he considered this, as he was processing this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, and he said, Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. Another message, and part of the conversation says, part of the verse says, all of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. The first thing I want to let you know is this. Sorry, can you move to the next slide? The first thing I want you to know about interruption is this, that God allowed it, and we must accept that interruptions are part of God's divine plan. You must accept that interruption is actually part of God's divine plan. You see in the Bible, Cain and Abel, they were supposed to be the seed of Adam and Eve, but it did not happen. There was an interruption. When Abraham got his finally long overdue promised son, Isaac, right? The Bible says he had his son and there was quietness for a while. And then suddenly, Genesis 22, it says, suddenly, Genesis 22 says, suddenly God appeared to Abraham and then asked him to sacrifice his son, Isaac. And that's the story. We hear the story of Naomi. Naomi and her husband escaped from famine to a new land, ready to start a new life. And all of a sudden, interruption. Her husband died. 10 years later, her two sons died, leaving her with two daughters-in-law. Interruption. We know stories of Daniel, Jonah, Paul. The disciples of Jesus Christ had various and countless interruptions in their lives. Let me propose this to you. Let me propose that life is a series of interruptions. I say this again. Life is a series of interruptions. Some of you here today are perhaps going through certain interruptions in your life and certain disruptions in my life. While preparing for this message, it's about 2 months. I had two major interruptions. We had two major interruptions in our lives. And this was part of it. This was key to my response. The first is I have to accept that God allowed it and it is part of God's divine intervention, divine plan. What does the Bible say about this? As believers of Jesus Christ, Romans 8 verse 28, it says, and we know that in all things, God works for the... Come on, Kajang. And we know that in all things, God works for the... of those who have been called according to His purposes. Romans 8 verse 28. We know in all things, not in some things, not in certain interruptions, not in interruptions that we prefer, no. But in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him. Some of you need to take this verse down, Romans 8 verse 28, and meditate on it and declare upon your interruptions or your disruptions in life. Remember last time I came, I look back at my calendar. I actually came also in December. And I shared, remember my message? Maybe not. Because sometimes we can't even remember last week's message. I'm asking you to remember last year's message. I shared about Moses encountering in the burning bush. And he asked God, right? He asked God, he said, Lord, who am I? And God said, I will be with you. Basically, God failed SPM lah, because he didn't answer the question. Lord, who am I? God said, I will be with you. You know what? Perhaps Moses was waiting. Moses was waiting for a pat on the back. Hey, Moses, you're my favorite child, highly blessed. You're deeply favored. Come on, Moses, you're the leader of the Israelites. You can do it. He perhaps was waiting for that. But God did not give that. God gave him, instead of an answer, God gave him assurance. Some of you are stepping into 2020 looking for answers. I want to remind you, friends, brothers and sisters, young people, God sometimes do not provide us answers. He provides us assurance that He will be with you. What is Christmas? Christmas is Emmanuel, God with us. And then the verse says, when Joseph woke up after the dream, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded and took Mary as his wife, but he did not have sexual relations with her until her son was born, and Joseph named him Jesus. The next thing that I want to point out here is, can you move to the next slide, please? Is how we respond is more important than how we feel. I want to encourage you, friends, to always respond to interruptions in a manner that glorifies God. Now, Joseph could have done many things, trust me. Men, if we were Joseph, we may not have reacted like that, like what the Bible says. We may have walked away. We may have questioned God. Have you said this to God before? I've done it. I've said this a few times, but I've stopped it. I said, Lord, I serve you. I do all this for you, but why? Why does this happen to me? As though God owed me a favor. Joseph could have responded like that. Lord, I come every Sunday. Lord, I do so many things behind the scenes. Lord, but why? Why me? Why you choose to do this to me? You see, sometimes, friends, it's not about what we feel, right? But it's how we respond. Who are we glorifying? Glorifying ourselves or glorifying the name of Jesus? According to the Jewish law, he cannot sleep with her for up to a year. Otherwise, like I said, it will equate to adultery. But see what he chose. He chose, the Bible says, he abstained from any sexual relations with her until the son was born, despite knowing that she was a virgin and she conceived through the Holy Spirit. You know, some interruptions in our lives happen. Friends, let me tell you this. to humble you, to humble me, and to test you and to test me. Abraham and Isaac, Joseph the dreamer, Naomi and Ruth, a story. How about Nehemiah, the builder of the wall? Many interruptions. Interruptions in life. Look at it this way, at this perspective, that it humbles us and it will test us of our response and our worship to God. After the dream, the Bible didn't say Joseph knelt down and worshiped God. No. But Joseph did what was right and according to the word of the Lord. It's easy to lift our hands, you know, friends. It's easy to lift our hands and worship God. But it is more difficult. I'm not saying don't worship. No, what I'm saying is it is even more difficult how you respond toward a particular situation and interruption and disruption in your life. Amen? Job, clear interruption. He lost almost everything. Talking about loss, let me share with you this story. Somewhere in the middle of the year, my wife texts me. I was not in KK. I was out abroad. She texts me, Pastor so-and-so, a very close pastor friend in Sabah, had his house burned down, right? Had his house burned down by a human error. The house just caught fire, and it's unlivable. And so she sent me a copy and paste message by the pastor requesting for help, and so on and so forth. So I just quickly reply back. And this pastor was very, very dear friend to us. He does a lot of things in his ministry that I learn from, and I speak to him when I need issues because he's way much older, been in ministry for 40 years. So I got a lot to learn from him. So I just told Deb, I said, just give him, just bank in some money to him. Right? But I said, when I come back, we'll go and see him. 2 weeks later, I came back. And the first person I contacted the following day was him, and I went out to him. Went out for a drink with him. And I said, Pastor, how are you doing today? How is everything now? So he shared with me the struggles, what happened to the home, what actually happened, how even 2 days later his son needed to fly to France to further his studies, but the passport all got burned down. He shared me everything. And I was like, whoa, what? And he and his wife was not at home. They were in Ranau doing ministry. And yeah, it's just not your best situation. How many of you know that not in the most situation that is not in your best, not in your favor, is the best place for God to intervene? Yesterday, we saw him at a wedding, right? Just a few hours ago. And he told us, wow, this is the best Christmas gift. He had more than enough to renovate his house. And now he's living in there just yesterday. So anyway, we were having coffee, and he was telling me this, and I was just so heartbroken. And I said, okay, Terrence, enough about me. What about you? What's new? So I started telling. I said, I just went here and did this thing and teaching and et cetera. I can't really remember. I said, oh yeah, Pastor, you may want to know. I just started studying also, and I just enrolled in a master's program, and this is what I'm doing. I said, oh, okay. So who's funding you? I said, no, I'm funding on myself. God has been gracious. God has been great. I said, oh, okay, all right. Just talking to me. And then the conversation continued. 5-10 minutes later, I could see his trail of mind just trailed off, right? He just wasn't listening anymore to what I was talking. And then suddenly he just put his coffee down. He said, Terrence, tell you what. He's like half standing, half sitting, you know, like just trying to like confront me. Terrence, I tell you what. I'll give you X amount for your master's program. I looked at him. I said, Pastor, no, I'm not asking for money. And I wasn't, right? I was just updating him. No, I'm not asking. You go and settle your houses. No, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. I need to do this. Give me your account. He just was direct to me. I said, no, Pastor, no. I was being Asian, not all Asian, right? I said, Pastor, I cannot accept it. You know, your house, this and... You don't worry about it. The Holy Spirit spoke to me. And this was right 2 weeks later. And long story short, I went to the car. Tears were all flowing in my eyes. I learned 2 things that day. One was that generosity flows not with what we have, but what we don't have. The second thing I learned was how we respond is more important than what we are feeling If I were him, I can't be I can't afford to sponsor people or do things for other people, you know? I got my house to think about. I won't use this story to say that God continued to bless him more, but after that week, I saw how God continued to bless him above and beyond, that his house just looked completely different from what it was when it got burned down. Maybe it was how he responded to my situation or many other situations. I don't know. Only God knows. But friends, let me tell you this. And this is a story that I learned. I was so humbled by it. And I'm now beginning to practice what I've learned. How you respond is more important than how you feel. Amen. And then the verse says, and part of the story where the angel confronted Jesus and the angel said, and she, Mary, will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. As part of my final point this morning, I want to share with you that interruptions is God's invitation to reveal Jesus. Remember the story in John chapter 9, where you may want to take this down and go and meditate on this portion. It's powerful. Where the disciples and Jesus saw a blind man. And the disciples asked Jesus, Lord, who sinned? Is it this man or is it his parents who have sinned that caused him to be blind? What Jesus said, none of this, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. Friends, interruptions happen in our life, just like for Joseph, obviously, is to reveal the Messiah, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the hope of glory, the name above all names, Jesus Christ. I want to read to you, this book is written by my wife. It's called Live to Last. Some of you may have this book. We actually brought some for sale. Did I say how much? No. So we're going to have a Christmas thing for you guys. We normally sell it outside 35, but we'll sell one for 30 here. But today, buy one, free one. You pay 60 ringgit, buy one, free one. Why are you laughing? Not good a deal. No, I'm just joking. Yeah, you buy two at 50, okay? Anyway. This story is very raw. I mean, not raw for us, but very, very, very personal to us. But she had the courage to write this down in a book. In 2012, she was pregnant. But the when we went to the doctor, the gynecologist declared that it's a miscarriage. And let me read a blurb from here. And it says, the day finally came for our doctor's appointment. It also marked our fourth wedding anniversary. And on the day of our wedding anniversary, we had been married for 4 years and the blissful years went by in a flash. We had fallen in love over and again and there was every reason to celebrate. Only that this day also marked the end of our little baby. The final visit confirmed that there was now an absence of heartbeat, silence, the death of what could be. Death of a vision that was about to become reality, the death of a dream. It was hard to grapple with death, but it was even harder to grapple with a hope that was strongly entrenched in my desire to be a mother. Interruptions. And the story continues. And finally, 1 year later, after a series of events, right? We tried man's way, but man's way failed. The only way else we can look for is God's way. And she said, I prayed the same prayer Hannah did in the story of 1 Samuel. When she dedicated Samuel to God, even before she was conceived, I knew that this child, so now she's pregnant, now is with Seth, is a gift from God, and we as parents ought to be good stewards to God's gift. Our lives glowed with pride despite the tiring first few months of taking care of a newborn. My desire to become a mother was finally fulfilled, and my heart overflowed with gratitude. In the first year of Seth's life, something new was stirring in our hearts. A new season was about to unfold, now with a child in tow. So if you know our story, or if you heard our story before, through Seth, God spoke to us also, and then we moved to Cambodia to live for 2 years before going to Sabah. There are lessons you will only learn if you go through storms, if you go through interruptions. There is beauty in your chaos and purpose in your pain. Dig deep as you weather the storms of life. Don't let them pass you by. Not all storms come to destroy and wipe away, but some storms come to clear so that you can see the path ahead. Not all disruptions or interruptions happen in our life to cause you pain, to purposely cause you pain, no. But certain interruptions happen, so they just clear the mess away, clear the leaves, clear the smoke, clear the path, clear that you will see what is ahead. And friends, what is ahead of you is not just blessing. What is ahead of you is not just breakthrough. What is ahead of you is the reason we celebrate Christmas, the name of Jesus, the name above all names. Hallelujah. Can I have the worship team up just a bit? Some of us here, we've come to church for 2-3 times. This is your first, second, third time. You're new. Some of you have heard the Christmas story, but just let it pass you by. I just want to say this to some of us here. You've heard the Christmas story many times, but you've not really made a response. I'm here not to give you a fact that Jesus came and died for your sins. I'm here to give you truth that Jesus came, hung on the cross, and died for your sin. Because we were once sinners. The Bible says, for the wages of your sin leads to death, is death. But the gift of God, which is the Son of God, which is Jesus Christ the Messiah, is eternal life. This morning, there may be some of you here who need to respond to this name. You may be seated here having a tug in your heart, even as the carols were sung, even as the word that was shared, even whatever that is shown on the screen. Or maybe your friend has been telling you about this name, Jesus, but you've never really truly made a response. If you're here and you want to make a response, I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to ask you to come in front or do any funny things. All I'm asking you, just gently lift up your hands. If you want to accept Jesus as your Savior, if you want to accept Jesus as your Master, instead of being the master of your own life, you know, today it sounds very trendy. I am the master of my own fate. You know, we all say that, I am the master. I decide where I want to go. Friends, let me tell you this. If we are masters of our own fate, we are but human. There is not every trial, not every temptation. We have that strength to go through it. You need someone, and that someone is a Savior, and that Savior, His name is Jesus. If you're here for the first time or here for the first few times, if you've never really received Jesus, would you just raise your hand? So I can see, someone will come to talk to you later and will walk you through the Christian faith. Is there anyone? Before I carry on, if you want to receive Jesus for the first time, I don't want to take it for granted because I don't know all of you. There may be some of you who have not received Jesus or you are doubting your salvation. You just raise your hands that I may see it. Anybody? Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God that all of us here are saved under the grace of God and not under law. Praise God that all of us here are saved not through works, but the grace of Jesus Christ. And I want to give this call before we end today's service. Some of you are going through disruptions, interruptions in your life. Many of us, we hide it. It may be an unfair decision at your workplace. It may be an unfair decision to a certain parenting decision, whether your parents are still alive or they are not alive. An unfair decision. It may be an interruption of your health. Today, we want to stand by you as brothers, sisters, and friends, as a community of faith. The Bible says we call this a household of faith. We want to stand together and pray along with you. If that's you tonight, and if that's you today, this morning, you're going through interruptions in your life, would you just raise your hands up and we can pray with you? Just leave it up. Yeah, don't put it down. Just leave it up. I'm just giving you 5 more seconds to respond. The rest of us, anybody who needs prayer, just have your hands up. Don't put it down. I'm just going to do something. All right? Hands up. Don't put down. All right, the rest of us, you see these hands. Lift your hands up. You see these hands. Whoever is near that brother, whoever is near that sister, whoever is near that young man, a young lady, would you just go around, lay your hands, and pray for that person? All right? Lift your hands up. So just look around. Lift your hands up. All right? You can stand, everyone. You can move. Go to that person. Surround that person and pray for that person. Even as the worship leads us in this song of worship, even the worship team leads us in this song of declaration of the love of Jesus. The rest of us, pastors, leaders, would you go around and just pray for those of them who have lifted up their hands? Elders, the board, just go around. Lay your hands on them. Thank you. Just lift your hands up, those of you who need prayer. Hallelujah, we praise you. Jesus, the name above all names. The name above all names. Come on, the rest of us who are not involved or who just want to sit around, come on, I encourage you, just go around. We are the household of faith. If we cannot go around and pray, who else will, right? Just go to someone, just bless them. They do not need to hear your prayer, but you just declare it in the atmosphere. Just declare it in the spirit realm. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. I declare breakthrough. Even as we call on your name, we declare breakthrough in Jesus' name. Church, why don't we just stand? Why don't you just lift up your hands? Why don't you just call on the name of the Lord? For He is the light of the world. He has come to give us light. Hallelujah. Let's worship God. Just surrender. Just surrender. Surrender your interruptions. For all things work together for the good of those who love Him. Now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think of. Even as we lift, you lift your hands, the promises of God are yes and amen. Jesus, we declare breakthrough. We declare change, transformation. We ask God that you give us a sign. Won't you call on the name of the Lord? Jeremiah 33 verse 3 says, call unto the name of the Lord and He will give you great and unsearchable things. Let's call upon the name of Jesus. Come on, church, lift your voices. Let's call upon the name of Jesus. Call upon.
Just lift up your voices. Call upon the Jesus. Call upon the Lord.
Call upon the name of the Lord.
And be saved.
Hallelujah. Call upon the name of the Lord. And be saved.
Would you call upon the name of the Lord? Will just break through into your situation. Just call upon the Lord. Call upon the name. Call upon His name right now into your situation. Into your interruptions. Yes, God. God will lead you through out of that situation. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we call upon your name. Faith, Lord. Oh, yes, the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Rabba Shikiri and Rabba Sadai. Oh, yes, the Lord. Yes, the God, Lord. We worship you, Lord, right now. We worship you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, you are our Lord. You are our God.
All together worthy, all together wonderful to be.
Come, listen, lift up.
Lord, in all this while, Lord, you have been so good, oh God. You have been so good to us, Lord. And we remember, Lord, what you have done for us. Remember, oh God, the Lord has been your grace, your mercy, your love, the Lord, that has led us through all our lives. And we know that God is the same grace, same mercy, same love that's going to lead us through. Even as we look ahead in the future, oh God, for what is to come. The Lord, you have never failed us and you will never fail us. We thank you, Lord. Lord, let our lives rise up in worship, oh God, unto you. And I know that God, are people here, Lord, that's just going through, Lord, situations, challenges, whether personal or some family members, whether it's in their workplace, oh God, or anywhere else, oh Lord. That God, today's message is just a reminder and an assurance to us as well. That God, Lord, as we call out to you, that God, Lord, as we call out to you, that God, our faith will arise. Doubts will cease. Fears and worries will fade away. Because, Lord, in your presence, oh God, that, Lord, there is confidence that, God, you, Lord, will never fail us. You will never disappoint. You will never neglect us or forsake us. Because your presence, as your name, Emmanuel, is that you are with us. That you will always be with us, oh God. So I call forth, oh God, your assurance. I call forth, oh God, your blessings upon your people. Today, Lord, even as we respond to you in worship, that God, we worship you, Lord. We thank you, God. We give all the praise and glory, oh God. Because, Lord, you have always been a faithful God. You have always been, oh God, a good God. And you have always been a great God, an awesome Lord. And God, indeed, look, God, we just stand right now and just give you praise. Come on, church, just give him praise. Just give him the praise. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Lord, you see the praise of your people, Lord God.